Some of you may remember the news of the disappearance of the Malaysian airline a couple of years ago. A few days after that incident, it was reported that there were two passengers on board with stolen passports. Their photographs were shown all over the media. As soon as I saw the pictures, I immediately recognized the younger man. That person was me. Even though it was three decades earlier, a different airport and different circumstances, I'm certain that if in 1982 there were cameras at every security checkpoint in Madrid airport, I would have had the same look on my face as that young man did. That look of fear, exhaustion, confusion, shock, and guilt. In the past several years, almost on a daily basis, we have seen pictures of people fleeing their countries and seeking refuge elsewhere. I have recognized that look on all those faces, young and old. While the story did not end well for that young man and for thousands of other refugees, I was one of the lucky ones. I grew up in Iran. My family practiced a religion called the Baha'i faith. I was introduced to the principles of unity of humankind, world peace, equality of women and men, nonviolence, and tolerance. I felt at home with these values. Outside the house, there was a different reality. The secular government in those years had done what it could to provide relative security and freedom. However, culturally, there was discrimination and violence by small group of Iranians against Baha'is. From an early age, I had an awareness that I was a minority, that I did not fully belong in my own country. As a six-year-old waiting for my school bus, I was called a najis, which means unclean, untouchable. I was not brave enough myself to challenge those kids in school, but witnessed mischievous Baha'i friends who would use any opportunity to touch or hold hands with those kids. I was called a dog. I had rocks thrown at me. I was good at ducking and never threw back a rock. I was a good student and was completely focused on getting the best education I could and to do something meaningful with my life. With the 1979 Islamic Revolution, the world for many Iranians turned upside down. We were still confused about how a revolution that demanded social justice and better life for all citizens morphed into a theocracy and an authoritarian regime. The development of American hostage crisis, the eruption of the Iran-Iraq war, the crackdown by the new regime on personal freedom, and forcing women to wear hijab clearly signaled a different future. For me personally, it meant the end of life as I knew. I had worked so hard to pass the entrance exam to medical school right after high school, but I was informed that I could continue my education only if I recant the religion I was born into and become a Muslim. I could not do either of those. How I presented myself outwardly was the essence of who I was, and I viewed mandatory clothing, especially for women only, as systemic oppression, and surely a sign of worse things to come. And even though I was not religious, being a Baha'i was the core of my being, and I refused to denounce my faith. I began to contemplate a life of self-exile, somehow making it to the U.S., where part of my family lived, and where I could go to school. By then, the government had limited traveling abroad, and thousands of Iranians were being smuggled out every night. I knew this would be a one-way trip, that I had to secretly and illegally escape Iran without saying goodbye to people I loved, that in most likelihood, I would never go back or see my grandparents again. We may think that we always have choices, but sometimes we only have one option, not much that we can control, and no guarantees. I took that option. My last memories of being with my family in Iran are me incognito boarding a bus in Tehran. My mom and my uncle were there. We all were quiet and stony-faced. They got me some fresh raw pistachio from the street vendor in those newspaper cones. My mother knew pistachios were my most favorite snack, but we both knew that this symbolic act of love was supposed to sustain me for a while. I pretended I was going to the western border city of Tabriz to see relatives. I had already given my documents and foreign currency to the smugglers, so I did not carry anything indicating that I had other plans in mind. From that moment until 4 days later, my co-travelers and I were nocturnal. My co-travelers were a man called Ben, with his wife Tara, who was 7 months pregnant, and their three-year-old daughter. There was also a young man, Kian, my age, who was escaping because he did not want to be drafted. And lastly, a young woman, Layla, who, like me, wanted to go to school without having to worry what she wore. We met because we had paid the same band of smugglers. We were together for 7 days, and then we went our separate ways and have not seen each other since. We completely understood and held each other up during those days. Traveling through the mountains into Turkey took us 3 nights on horseback, on foot, car drives, crossing rivers and hiding in ditches anytime the border security floodlights came on. Traveling in the dark had one advantage. I couldn't see, thankfully, but I could sense that we were riding horses on a narrow path at the edge of deep cliffs. We also rode through creeks and rivers. I was thinking, why did I not ask the smugglers back in Tehran specifically what the trip entailed? I did not know we were going to ride horses or be at the edge of high cliffs or cross rivers. Did I hear someone fall into the river? I could not see anything. No one talked about it. We just continued riding. Later that night, we walked silently for hours without seeing or knowing anything about the landscape. I was shivering the whole time and wondering how Tara could do this while pregnant. We ran into so many other groups, other shadows running through the mountains away from Iran. We were coming across the border security lights too many times. I thought, we should have already crossed the border. How wide is the border between two countries? Were the smugglers just taking us in circles to make it look harder? But they did not speak Farsi, and no one in our group spoke Turkish, so we just followed them and kept walking. During daylight, we hid in caves away from roads or any other signs of civilization. We were supposed to rest. Each of us dozed off briefly on the rocks, but we were all too anxious to rest. The smell of the freshly baked bread and cheese we were offered was wonderful, but we were too anxious to enjoy it. We were getting more quiet each night of walking. I noticed that the smugglers were changing at each stop. I guess that was how it's done. Physically exhausted already, we were just putting one foot in front of the other until Tara stopped and told us she could not walk anymore and wanted us to go and leave her there. Keon, Layla, and myself decided to take turn carrying the little girl so Ben could help his wife. I don't remember how many more hours of walking we did those nights. We had nothing to see in the dark. We didn't allow ourselves to talk or feel. We were saving our energies. We were all already in survival mode. We eventually arrived somewhere, maybe a village. There was commotion and lots of noise. We thought it was the Turkish police. Maybe it was. But we were pushed very quickly into some villager's house in a room with heat and light. There, we were able to eat and rest for a few hours. But suddenly, maybe 3:30 in the morning, we were awakened and signed to move. I don't remember how it was communicated to us that we were going to be dropped off somewhere and we were to wait at the side of the road until a car would come to bring us to the border city. Anyhow, that is what we did in the dark. A couple of hours passed, and the sun was coming up, and there was still no car. This is where we all thought it was over. How could five people and a child be huddling at the side of a road and not attract attention? Then the sun was fully up, cars passing, people spotting us. We just stayed there in the ditches at the side of the road. Eventually, a van came and signaled us to get on. We arrived to the border city and were checked into an inn. This is where eventually we saw the leader of the smugglers we had met back in Iran, and where he was supposed to deliver our luggage, cash, and documents. Well, he denied that he was carrying any cash for us. And we found out that they had to throw away some of our luggage during the last nights. And shockingly, I received a half-burned passport. So I had heard it right. Someone had fallen into the river the first night. It was one of the smugglers, and just my luck, he had been carrying my passport. He tried to dry it over fire. So in addition to the smudges and water stain, it had burnt marks all over it. I did not have any words. I did not move. I did not know what to do. My brain went to work. What does this mean? Now I have no document to show who I was, and I have no money. What are my options? What can I do? Is going back to Iran an option? I'd surely be jailed and worse. But I did not have anything in my repertoire of what I had learned at school or life experiences that could help me find a solution for this. I felt defeated. My mind came back to the room and I heard Ben shouting furiously at the smuggler. He was so angry for what his wife had gone through. He had paid extra and was promised that his family would not experience any harm. He was frustrated with everything we all had experienced on this trip so far, and now with all this bad news. We were supposed to be brought to Ankara, but the smuggler was now demanding more payment. Ben rejected that and fired him right there. The next 4 days happened quickly for me. I was still in a state of shock. Ben and Tara took charge of our little group. They were maybe 15 years older than the rest of us, but seemed to know how to navigate those waters. Somehow, we got to Ankara. We celebrated this success in our hotel room. It was too risky to be out. Ben and Tara did not have to do it, but they took care of me and somehow found people who forged documents. They bought a brand new fake passport for me and found the right people and places to bribe to let everyone in our group exit Turkey. We said our goodbyes in the airport. Tara, Ben, and their little girl had residency in Austria, so they went there. Leila and Kian had student visas and went to Germany. And I boarded a plane to Spain. I arrived in Madrid stressed and fearful. The Spanish customs officer would for sure realize that I was traveling with this fake passport. This was the easiest part of my trip, though. I was planning to apply for asylum in Spain. Had I been caught at the airport, I could apply right there. I guess the passport looked real enough that I entered Spain and immediately went to a telephone booth to call my mother. We had already decided on a new name for me and some code language to use during this phone call. Hearing that, my mother said she was very happy that I managed to see the Picasso Museum in Barcelona. I could hear her crying, but I knew she was smiling too. I came out of the phone booth and saw my cousin in front of me. I thought Spaniards could look like Iranians, only that she called my name and ran towards me. I collapsed to the floor. The psychological trauma and all the emotions I had buried for the past 7 days poured out, and I cried for a long time there on the floor. I had no idea that she also had escaped a few days before me through Pakistan. That day, September 24th, 1982, was my birthday. I turned 21. Fake passport and burned passport in hand, and with the letter I had from the Iranian authorities informing me that I was not allowed to be a student any longer since I was not a Muslim, I went to the UN office in Madrid. I was declared stateless. I had to go to the UN office and my local police station every month to report that I was still in Spain. I lived with my cousin for one year while I applied for residency in the US or Canada. Qualifying for a humanitarian program offered by the Canadian government, I was welcomed as an immigrant to Canada in 1983. My host families and Canadian government programs for new immigrants allowed me to grieve, to recover for the most part, and to learn the new life skills I needed. In Canada, I was given dignity, freedom, and opportunity. I went to school, and even though I did not become a physician, I was able to contribute in a very small way to the understanding of basic science of cancer and immune diseases. I was recruited by a biotech company here and moved to San Diego. While my birthland denied me freedom, Turkey was my rescue, Spain became my refuge, Canada, my motherland, restored me, and the US became my homeland. We see pictures of refugees and hear stories of what they go through. As unbelievable the stories may sound, they are what people really face. Refugees are traumatized at home and traumatized trying to get to a safe place. To find a way forward, we have to fake our identity, lie, and bribe to get to a place where we can once again be who we are. The overriding identity we all share by the virtue of existing in the form that we do is the human identity. All everyone is seeking is to be free, to be dignified, to matter, and to do something that matters. Thank you.